Greetings in the name of the Most High. I'm so sorry that you've let all this happen to your country, but, you know, we'll just go on from here. Zeph Daniel here.
I'm trying not to put blame on people, you know, and I'm trying not to be so angry because obviously when you see people doing things, you know, I would prefer that my kids not be taught by pedophiles, you know what I mean? But of course here that's unconstitutional, or I'm being racist or something. I don't know what to do with this thing. So I'm going to focus in on the pity partiers out there and the fact that, you know, you're walking along with Jesus, but now you're bummed out. Well, there's a reason you're bummed out. And that's because I spent all night researching blood sacrifice in ancient paganism and neo-paganism today. And the pagans today, and Wicca, and witchcraft. And I can tell you that's the whole reason Congress was cowed. You know, you had a super majority that you'd never had in 130 years, and then they just bowed down and gave Obama everything. They go, well, they're all blackmail. No. They're afraid of the witchcraft, because people wind up dead all the time. It's just an example. And they're told, if you don't vote this way, or you don't do anything that way, we'll kill your children. And that's why they're not talking. So we got ourselves a bad situation here, folks. And when it comes to this time of year, there's so much going on. And you have to realize, since America is ISIS, ISIS is America, all the killing that's going on there is counted as a sacrifice as well, you know, for power. And it looks like, you know, the Zeph report once again was confirmed 1,000%. And it's even worse than I had said. I mean, it's even more hands-on than what I ever suggested. And I was the only one for a while that was, you know, everyone would say, well, we funded them like Al-Qaeda, but then they just grew into this force. It's like, no, it was hands-on every day. Costumes, planning, training, Hollywood, the whole bit. Yep, that's right. Turns out to be true. And, you know, not that I like to toot my horn and say I'm right, but I mean, that's what I saw in those visions I have. Whenever I have them, and they're rare. I don't know when another one's going to come, but that whole John Wayne thing that I had, I mean, that is, look at what's happened. It's all true. So I was tapped into something there. I can't tell you right. I'm not going to do that. I'm not a, you know, here's the psychic phone network or some guy, you know, performing for you in the circus. So it's, you know how it is. It's just like the Lord gives me stuff on occasion when it's happening, then you really need to heed, you know, but then you've got to have the, well, I had many Christians tell me that I was full of it. Not many, but you know what I mean? Say, well, I think it's this way, and I think it's that way. Everyone, I'm saying, no, I had a vision. You understand? And, oh, well, I think it's this way. Okay, well, fine. We're all Christians then, right? God. Everyone's got an opinion. I mean, everything is confusion. Thing is, your opinion's wrong and mine wasn't. You know, got a track record here? You don't. But you don't care. You're going to still shoot your own mouth off with your own mind. That's fine. I'm not saying listen to me because I can't tell you if it'll ever happen again. I don't know. But from what I've seen, and the funny thing is, it's almost like there's a conflict within. What I see is a conflict within the military, within the government, everywhere. There is some kind of pushback on this totalitarian global takeover, misery on steroids thing. So you people are having pity parties, you know, I don't blame you. You know, I may not be able to give you a pep talk today, but this time of year is the highest witchcraft in the world. People go, no, it's Beltane. It's just, no, it's not. It's right now. And I can just tell you that it's all arrayed against, you know, it's like a big beam weapon, which is witchcraft. Trying to make you, all the gang stocking weapons are witchcraft. Just a hint, so you get it, so you get on, you know, so you can get with the Lord, right? So you understand what you got to do, right? Or are you going to keep figuring out? You know, there are shills out online that go around telling people when they start thinking of the spiritual reasons for gang stalking, that they actually, they try to correct everyone back into thinking about technology and perps, who steer them away from that kind of thinking. Those are not TIs, they're shills, they're your enemy. Wake up! They'll do anything in their power to not have you figure out that it's a spiritual battle that's being manifested through interdimensional weaponry, most of which isn't even here. It disappears. It comes back. I told you it's not a contiguous reality. I told you. How many times do I have to tell you to not go with your own mind, with your own understanding? But there's some things that are unexplainable. You have to have faith for that. Let the Lord show you those things. How many times have you gone back to your own feeble understanding? That's why you're so bummed out. You know, you have to understand something. This is an interdimensional, a wild thing. There's many levels to this. It's a mistake to think that they win and you're just sitting here waiting to die. They're now bringing in radical jihad, Islamic. Well, the Islamic, it's kind of a joke because the American and Western powers run Islam. And they make it look like it's these Arabs. They did this back in the days of Lawrence of Arabia. I mean, this is an old thing, using the Arab and the whole jihad thing as a weapon of Western powers to be used against their own people. That's the whole point of the terrorism. So they can pass laws, and so they can grab all the power and give you nothing, put you in a little cage, call it good for the earth, while they go off and play golf like Obama in Hawaii. Aren't you enjoying that, the golf games? The press is, they're wildly applauding him. They're feeling so grateful to be with the emperor. I mean, how could you stand it? Quentin Tarantino coming up with his movie, and he's a big Obama supporter. He says Obama's the biggest, the best president in his lifetime. How deceived can a man get? I cannot trust someone that's that far gone. I will not trust him with taking 3 hours of my life for his stupid entertainment. I won't watch it. I like the fact that Kurt Russell's in there. I support him, but the rest of them I don't know about. And as far as he's concerned, this pretentious little F word, doing it in 70 millimeter with intermission, all that. Those were like the movies I used to see by great directors back when I was a kid. He ain't no great director. You know, unless you're a left-wing ideologue, then you'll like what he's like Michael Moore. You know, just pushes his agenda. That's all he does. So, you know, the idea that they film it in 70 millimeter is a joke to a joke to a joke. And the people that get snared into seeing the Hateful Eight, you people are all pretty much dupes and robots and automatons. I'm not going to give... Had he just done a normal movie because of Kurt Russell being in it, I probably would have given him the time of day. But now that he's doing this whole pretentious thing on and actually ruining the movies of old, like Lawrence of Arabia and some of these other ones, making a joke out of them, I'm no. I mean, this is further denigration of... the film industry and you know, the tawdriness of it all, and I just can't watch it anymore. I look for those gems that come out of Hollywood. You know, I do read The Hollywood Reporter, and I'm always horrified and bummed out when I see that. You talk about a pity party. I just read that, and then I want to open a vein. It's horrible. But, you know, to them, life has never been better than people that work in Hollywood. Hollywood is a boomtown right now. Oh, you're not booming? You got to be tied in with Washington. You got to be tied in with the New World Order. Come on. Then you'd be booming too. I think you're beginning to understand just how completely defeated, you know, Western humans are. I mean, so bad. We've been routed so bad that that's why they're out playing golf and enjoying themselves. Because you were nothing. Beating you was easy. Look what they did. They don't like a general? Oh, just toss him his ass out of there. They figure the general will never give him trouble again. Well, I think there's a fight back among these good generals, and we certainly need God-fearing generals in our military. My God, how did we wind up with the pagans running the military? How the criminals running the CIA? How did it get to this where they could just do any false flag and have terror launch whatever? Oh, I need a terror attack. My numbers are slipping. Okay, Mr. President. Boom. You know, how in the world did it get to that point? And then if you even mention there was collusion, right? False flag. They have a whole squad of people that jump on you on Twitter and call you racist and all this stuff. You hate Obama because he's black. And they jump to that. The tinfoil hat. Go listen to Alex Jones. Go put on your tinfoil hat. There's this kind of stuff. When all of this has been proven, you know, that more and more info comes out all the time that's confirming, you know, one thing after another. A lot of these staged events for gun control and different things, they're completely staged. And all the proof is there. But the people just say, no, you're in a tinfoil hat. Right? Stupidest people, dumber than a box of rocks, is the media. The Washington Post and the Daily Beast and Politico. They are the stupidest people on earth, and yet they pretend to be brainiacs when they have no proof for their stances on most things. And it's unbelievable having to watch this. And I didn't want to go into a lot of geopolitics, so I'm not going to. Suffice to say that this time of year is always the worst in terms of vibes. It's always the worst because you're getting the beams, you're getting the ELFs, you're getting the spells and the spell casting, and you're getting a lot of that right now. That's just kind of, you know, the message is you have no future, you've completely defeated, no point for you to get out of bed, your children are going to be slaves, you're all going to be sacrificed, no one's even going to know your name in the future, your seed will be wiped out. And the only thing that's going to exist here are radical jihadis who are dancing up and down with a victory provided by Obama or whatever. You know, I'm you know, giving you the kind of the phantasm thing of it. But I mean, that's kind of the message. No need to fight back. You've already lost. It's too you're talking about a global army here. What are you going to do? You know what I mean? And so there's all that that's going on, along with witchcraft, which is basically, you know, making people that are already having trouble keeping their heads up above water. There's no hope. You have no job prospects for the future. Your kids were in college. There are no jobs waiting for them when they get out. By design, by the way, by the people you elected. And they know that. They're putting a halt to civilization because they want to bring in a new civilization on the destruction of this one. So, you know, it's going to be pretty depressing this year because you have a lot of witchcraft, a lot of spells, which also have a technological component to them. But it's all witchcraft. Make no mistake. If you make that mistake, you're going to be constantly looking for a perp that you will never find. It's the government. It's this guy. It's that guy. No. It's coming from a completely supernatural environment that you don't know anything about. And that is what's killing you every day. So, what do we do now? Well, you know, had you been more astute musically, you would realize that there was this little song produced called "The Whore of Babylon" or "The Queen of Babylon Falls," or "Fall." It was "Fail" for a while, and then it became "Fall." It was "Ends," but it's about Revelation 18 coming to pass, the end of the Queen of Babylon. Indeed, they're planning the end of the system too, and they are Babylon. They're planning the end of their own system. So there's always a, you know, when music comes out, there's always a reason. I don't know that, you know, you're not really tuned into it. Well, I guess, you know, I don't know what to say. You know, I'm sorry for you then, because, you know, all this stuff, there's a reason for all of it, you know, for all the things. You know, compartmentalizing yourselves. Now, I'm not saying you have to listen to my music. I'm just saying that, you know, there's a reason for things, you know. It's not like, well, let's do a Whore of Babylon song. You know, there's a reason for things. Oh, well, I'm not going to coerce you, you know. I'm going to be more like the Holy Spirit. I'm going to say, you know, because you can lead a horse to water, can't make him drink, you know. I'm not going to coerce you. There's just a flow is what I mean. If you're in that flow, you can understand what's going on. But everybody has an opinion. I talk to so many people that they all say, this is what's happening, that's what's happening. I'm like, and then I know quietly I don't criticize them, but I'm like, ah, they're completely off. They're completely off. They're completely off. They got it wrong. They got it wrong. And you know, that may be my opinion, but then when that proves to be true, they don't recant. They adopt another point of view. And I'm like, well, then you're all, and they also complain to me that they feel really lousy. So from my experience, having survived to this point And, you know, realizing I was one of the first humans on Earth to actually speak the truth about the gang stalking being supernatural and being guided by witchcraft. Because that's what I was shown when I was a boy. The whole way it all comes down, and all the people that coalesce and do it and all that, they meet and they, yes, they have their strings they pull, but it all goes back to witchcraft. Because the people that are participating in those groups that would then stalk you are themselves in covens and, you know, they're in their satanic circles, right? And the only reason they attack you is because, you know, you're somehow a threat because you belong to God or you're not one of them or whatever. There's some kind of reason. And, you know, usually it's because, you know, you're a threat because you're really out for the truth. You're out for Jesus. You know stuff you shouldn't know. You're a whistleblower, whatever. You know, I mean, there's all kinds of reasons. But if you keep it all terrestrial, then, you know, you're just going to be very, very much frustrated. You're going to be very much in pain. You're going to be very much hamstrung in terms of prayer, which is mighty and which changes things. And you're going to have very little faith. Unless you start realizing that you do have power, and in the midst of all this, your prayers are enough. And you can turn this around. I don't need to go the overview anymore about, you know, whatever, if Bush was playing golf. I mean, it didn't matter. They're all the same person, you know, Bush, Obama, they're all the same. It's all the same program. You go, well, Obama's a left-wing liberal. No, he's not. He's a globalist, totalitarian, authoritarian neocon. If anything, he's closer to the neocons, to the Bushes, and he's actually closer to the military-industrial complex than you know, he's not, you know, the friend of the liberals, but a lot of these liberals are really stupid. And they've done IQ tests, and I guess that really is true. They're just stupider than other people. They're gullible. They fall for it. Well, I don't fall, you know, I don't know, well, you fell for Trump. Trump is an engineered thing. Well, they're going to say that. But I already saw in a vision how Trump was lifted up as like a John Wayne character. And I see the Lord's hand on that. So I have complete 100% confirmation that I'm completely right and you're completely wrong. Because the Lord has confirmed it in the very beginning. And I've been there from the beginning. And no, I'm not going to change my tune because that's what God showed me. So you're wrong, I'm right, end of story. That's the way it's going to be. But then again, that's the usual. No, I'm wrong on stuff, and I admit it. And I thought that ISIS would be, you know, that Obama would be forced to get rid of ISIS by now. You know what I mean? And then there was this big fight at the Pentagon and at the CIA, and there's still an internal fight over the whole thing. They're still funding ISIS, even though it's now almost blasted out on mainstream news. No, Fox News and CNN, they're not allowed to talk about it. They know all about it, but they can't say it because they're all hamstrung because their kids might be killed. You know what I mean? It's on that level. It's not like we have a little some dirt on you. It's like you could be killed. You know, you deal with stuff, forces that are there that are very powerful, and people get killed right and left, you know, so people have to be smart, or else they won't survive to fight another day. We're already in World War IV, whatever it is, 5, 6, 7, whatever, name your pick. We're in a total hot war right now. Now there's no World War III coming. We're head deep in it right now. Well, I would have thought they'd be able to waltz right in, sit right down, you know. But they haven't, because you see, the Lord's showing me that we already have Babylon right now. We already have the New World Order right now. You know, it's the Western civilization, and it has thrived. And if it comes to an end, there's not a New World Order kind of thing. I mean, you know, this is still going to go on for a while. But these people believe that Lucifer will reign in the Age of Aquarius. Okay, I'm just going to be really straight up and honest with you. The Age of Aquarius more represents Jesus, if you like, rather than Lucifer, because Lucifer tries to win the kingdom by deceit, lies, and violence, as you know, which is not the Age of Aquarius, not the age of any kind of shift out of this Age of Pisces. Now, I'm not going to give it much more look than that, but you know, we're going to talk about ages. You also have the age end of the Kali Yuga, which is 2025, to give you some time context. The Bible seems to be coming to a mysterious close right now. Mysterious, very mysterious. Very interesting. I love it. I'm in Revelation 18. I don't know where you're at. You know, that's where I am. I'm getting plenty of food. You read through the book of Revelation now, you'll say, I never read it before. I can't believe it. Look at that. Exactly. I don't know what you people do out there without a Bible. You ought to get one while you still can. Most people misuse the Bible and read it as a terrestrial document. Well, if you want to torture yourself, go ahead. There's some inspiration there for you still. But hopefully it will open up via the Holy Spirit that's in you because you've given your life over to Jesus Christ. We have to die to self and accept Christ. That's why if I care about anything, like if I care about the result of the Zeph report or of a musical track or whatever, hey, I was still around when we used to sell MP3s and I had DJs all over the world playing my stuff, you know. Of course, before I shot my mouth off in my tracks. And I told you that all dried up because we were providing so many DJs with tracks that they would take a track and they would, you know, loop it and, you know, they would, you know, and it was no big deal. But I would put tracks up there on the Zeph Report page and you know, people would pay their 99 cents to download. And we made it. There's a couple of tracks that made several $1,000s. And you add that up, it's like, yeah, you can make a living out of that. And then suddenly it just all dried up with the streaming. And I mean, it all went, you know, the whole idea of the independent musician making any money at all went right out the window. And I watched all that happen. Now, the podcast really grew, on the other hand. So I could say, you know, look at the podcast. You know, it's thriving right now because it's so portable. You know, people don't need, you know, now you can stream all the podcasts if you like. So that's just really cool, you know. And music, I just kind of blend in with the podcast because it's all part of this flow, you know. And if you don't like I do a lot of different kinds of music. Like, I mean, I've been unable to settle. I kept thinking I was going to settle down back in 1974, this last couple of tracks, back to, you know, but I'm just such, you know, I'm an okay guitar player. I'm a really good producer, right? So I know when I want to hear from my guitars and my basses and my drums and whatever. You know, if I had other people here, easy to get them in here, and I do have people out there, bring them in to play, you know, but I play okay. You know, I play, like in the last track, everything I wanted to hear, everything I needed to do, I could do with the skill level I have on guitar and bass. I play a pretty mean bass, yeah. So, pretty mean drums, too. Well, if you want to see me as a drummer, you know, if you want to look at me as a drummer, listen to the last track. I played every note of that with the sticks and with my feet. And that's, you know, I hate to crow so much, but that's world-class drumming. I'm sorry. That's top A level. I may not be that on anything else. I know people out there that are like A-plus level guitarists. I mean, unbelievable. And have all the, you know, any kind of chops you want. Lots of people, lots of composers out there, A-list. Rich Keltner with his electronic beats. I just heard Jade Hell, and that's just one of the sickest beats I ever heard. And he created that whole thing out of nothing. So I'm like, wow, I'm surrounded with geniuses, you know? It's just amazing. And we're all, you know, out of work musically, you know? So we're sharing together, you know? We've become our own audiences, that's fine. But it would be nice if you guys would, you know, take the songs I do, you know, or that we do, that me and Gary and, or Rich and Jamie and Kelly and whatnot. I mean, Kelly, we've got some amazing tracks. I sent her a couple the other day of just Into the Shadowlands and whatever. I mean, this should be used on people's videos and, you know, go ahead. I give you permission to use all that stuff. Just give accreditation. So you should be using the music and putting it in your videos, putting it in your creations. Just, you know, a piece of it, you know, 20 seconds of it, 30 seconds, just like as bumper music. I give you total permission. Do I need to spell this out? Download it and use it. I know it says all rights reserved, but I'm telling you now, forget that. Just use them because it's important to get the vibe out there because it's coming from the opposite of the world. What if, you know, if you put the world's music on, if you put the world's music on your creations that are kind of going against the world system of slavery, You have a dichotomy there. Why don't you put something on that's on the same team you're on? Well, go ahead. I mean, I'm just to say, yeah, that's a good idea. Download it and use it in your next video. Just give credit where credit is, and you can have at it, you know? But the Jade Hill thing, it's got on sound, I mean, on Podbean, it has thousands of plays, you know? So I'm very happy with that because of Podbean. It just roared past the 2 million point. Now it's just going crazy. I don't know what it is. There's just a lot of lost people out there who need help. Hey, look, I wasted a lot of time today talking about nothing. You know, going over the political situation and the, you know, just touching the bases. And I'm sorry, you're bummed out. You're having a pity party. Well, that's what I'm here to help you with today. That's why I'm here. That's why I should have kept the focus. And I'm sorry. Well, I've been there, you know, and I know a lot of people that are just bummed out. A lot of broken hearts tonight, you know, today. The sun's coming up here. A lot of broken hearts, and, you know, the weather's all mysterious, and the witchcraft is out of control today. Today, Christmas Eve, are you kidding me? Everything is arrayed against God, against Jesus. So whatever day you say, it doesn't matter if he was born at Rosh Hashanah or born in the spring. It doesn't matter when he was born. The fact is, this is Christmas. So this would be the biggest warfare day of all. Oh, they say it isn't. Because they're always trying to say it's got nothing to do with it. It was here way before any Jesus or anything. No, it's all a war against God, period, from the very beginning of time. So Jesus being the jewel, the lamb, the whole point of everything, is going to be the focus of all witchcraft. And anybody that truly believes, not the lip service in the churches and the fake this and fake that and all these fake people. I mean, now it's like this is the time of Elijah, of the return of Elijah once again. And you know what that means. And if you like, prelude to something very big about to happen. And you can see it's about to happen. So this would be the biggest day of the year because it's all about the war on God. It's all about Psalm 2. Please get up to speed with me one day. Please, I beg you. Well, because see, if you're getting kicked all over the field, it's because you don't have sufficient faith or understanding. You know, you're miserable because you're ignorant, a lot of you. And you're ignorant because you just, it's all about, you know, everything that's what you can see, touch, and feel, rather than this expanded kind of view of everything that the Lord provides. So the Lord's not, he'll provide if you just let him, if you get out of the way. Now, look, I'm not being critical. I'm a grumpy old man. You know, maybe that's it. I've been through all these wars. I got scars all over my body, you know, all over my, literally scars. And I have, you know, other kinds of scars, but I have, you know, I have physical problems from this war with the witches and all the rest of it. I've been through this since childhood. I think I know a few things. I can impart them to you. And then you can pick up from there and go know even more things than me. But, you know, somehow we have to have some kind of way of transmitting information, because if we all just go on our own understanding, spitting around our own little vomit, you know, we just wind up being stupid. I don't know why I have to say that right now. I guess because so many of you are frightened, and because you're frightened, it's making you have a very small view, you know, of, and I don't blame you for being frightened. You're being beamed with ELF waves and all kinds of pollution all day long, and your television sets, and it's just one big bum-a-thon, bummed out-a-thon, if you will. So the more sensitive among us are having a pity party, and nothing's going to help. You're just in a morose depression, and that's it. You're just waiting to die. You've given up already. Well, I'm sorry, but there's a lot more to your life than what you think it is. And you're not going to stay in that pity party. I command it in Jesus' name. You come out right now in Jesus' name and stand up and start screaming and laughing and dancing. Oh, it may not happen this second, but it will. because something of you is like Lot's wife. You're holding on to the past. You're holding on to Sodom and Gomorrah when God said get out of there because he's going to nuke the place. Zeph Daniel just did a song called The Queen of Babylon, Fall. Fall of the Queen, based on Revelation 18. Why would Zeph do that? What's going on there? How did that come about? See, if you're in the flow, it all kind of makes sense. No, you don't have to listen to it, but just look at the title. Why is that there? You know, I've been buzzing around in Revelation 18, and I just can't seem to get it out of my mind. What is the entire point of Revelation 18? No, it's not because she's drunk of the blood of the saints and she's filled with her, you know, they've all fornicated with her and it's just so much evil. The cup is filled with iniquity, so it collapses. No, it's the vengeance of God. What's the point of chapter 19? It's the vengeance of God. It's the wrap up. What is the saint supposed to be like at the time of God's vengeance? Rejoice for the Lord avenges you, right? Is that it? You are to rejoice at his vengeance because he's avenging all the pure hearts, all the lambs that got slaughtered when you were in high school, all the prophets that got tortured and hurt because they spoke the truth, and anybody else in that category that was a lamb. You're living in a world where the dead prey upon the lambs, on the living, and God reverses it. That's Revelation 18. So therefore, rejoice because all that came before you, They're coming back and they're going to be rejoicing because God has cleansed the blood that cries up from the ground. He's made the situation good. He's brought justice to the whole thing. You know, Revelation 18 reminds me of a tin pot dictatorship of Satan, where a few people get to lavish themselves with all the luxuries of the earth. And everybody else is struggling to serve them who are the dead. If they're dead, let them go. It's a real thing when they initiate you and indoctrinate you into it. You are called the dead. Why do you think? Because you pass over to the other side. When Jim Morrison said that in his song, the other side is the side of death. It's right, and the dead then prey on the living. And that's, you know, even the Scorch Trials, Maze Runner knows that much. And I don't know if that guy's a Christian or not, but he knows that much. Why don't you? Here's a secular author. He knows that much. What about you? If you understand that, then you're not going to be bummed out at the world. The whole world's like that. Thousands of years before you even got here, it's been like that. The dead prey upon the living. Don't you know that? And then the demons run the dead. That's right. And that's the system we have here. And that's why it's important to keep prayer in the school, important to keep godly values, important to teach the kids the Bible or teach them about how what I love about the Bible is how people behave and you see what happens to them. Even Solomon, a big hero of the Bible, he went off the rails and he paid a price. And what I love is that they're imperfect people struggling along and it shows all the lessons, you know, so we can learn. It's just good to learn. But, you know, if we're ever going to have any kind of a life here, you know, the people need to have an exodus. There'll be a second exodus. That's the remnant. And the exodus is spiritual. And it's going on right now. And those people that have the exodus have to have faith because there's not much evidence out there that we can have anything. It seems the politics and the people and everything and the culture and the entertainment business, and it's all arrayed against, you know, anything that's godly, anything that's pure, anything that has virtue is all racist or dirty or awful or criminal or extreme or whatever. I mean, seems pretty overwhelming. But if you're in the Exodus, you're with God, you know that it's all a lie. The world system's based on lies. So they're going to throw at you demonically possessed. I was just watching the other day, and did I tell you this in the last podcast? I did. I think I did. If I didn't, I'm going to say it now. I was watching the 2014 Grammys, the opener with Beyonce and Jay-Z, and which is basically a satanic ritual on stage, right? I mean, it's pretty cut and dry, but I mean, it's constantly throwing in your face, you know, sexual imagery, and you know, she was basically sticking in your face the whole time. Then while she's sticking in your face, then he comes out and starts rapping like an idiot. I remember I told you I could see that there was a fake thing, you know, that you've been taught to like Jay-Z. You know what I mean? There's some kind of a supernatural thing that makes people sound better than they are. Something's, I saw a glimpse of that, you know, because I saw with that lens taken off, it's like, wow, he's not really anything, you know. Then it was back on again. He said, oh yeah, you know, wow, that's really tempting if you want to be out there and be a spectacle. I mean, you've got to sell your soul to the devil, and then you get this super, you know, talent thing. It's really that other people perceive it. It's like an other people lens perception thing, right? All the people, or you get sprinkled with fairy dust and everyone likes you. They can't explain why. They just have, that's how the Beatles were in the beginning, because that was the beginning of the invasion, right? That was the beginning of there was John F. Kennedy out the window, and then the Beatles coming in, and our culture tabled right then, and they just grew from there. Think about that next time you see Paul McCartney trying to go through his midlife crisis of being young again on stage. Try to look at it from that lens. Yeah. Then think about Michael Jackson as a blood sacrifice. Start thinking about the other artists. Start thinking about how brutal the whole system really is. Then you have your answers to why Congress, first time Republican majority in the House and Senate in 130 some odd years, gave everything away. Well, obviously they were scared to death. Of death. Oh no, this wasn't just simple blackmail. This was witchcraft on steroids. That's right, the New World Order is witchcraft. The whole UFO, you know, demonic thing that goes on is witchcraft. All the orbs flying around, yes, we talked about that recently, witchcraft. And what's the end goal of all the witchcraft? The war against God, ultimately to destroy humanity, to transmogrify the human genome so that, therefore, we have some kind of a altered DNA, therefore written out of the Lamb's Book of Life, because original creation done. Win-win, win-win, game over. The reason that the honchos of this world cannot win is because they're already dead. That's the deep, dark secret. They joke about it and call themselves the dead or the grateful dead. Why don't you ever pick up on that? You know, they give you enough clues. It's not like you're stupid. They show you what they're doing on at these, you know, the Super Bowl, the Grammys, and the Academy Awards. I mean, Hollywood is excellent at showing you, you know, the pyramids, the triangles, the all-seeing eye, the 666, and all the other stuff. Corporations with all their logos. I mean, all of this is coming from Hades. No, we're not all together going to sing Kumbaya. At best, there's a remnant. That's it. The rest are dead already. Yes, they're walking around and they, you know, they have some kind of supernatural power. Yes. You know, I like to call them sock puppets on this big, you know, God's big stage production. You know, they're like little, you know, they're like marionettes. But they're very deadly too. I mean, you know, they're sacrificing each other all day long and, you know, doing whatever they have to do to stay in the limelight, because that's the all-important thing. They'll kill their mothers, they'll kill their fathers, they'll kill their children, whatever, it doesn't matter to them. You have to understand how ruthless your enemy is. I think a lot of people are waking up to find, in Hollywood, a lot of celebs, to find out that they are held hostage, because they're still intact people, and they're surrounded by this reality that they cannot handle, but they can't go talk about it to anyone, because then they would be flagged as someone who's waking up. And if that happens, then they'd be gang stalked. And then they wind up like Roseanne Barr, that happened to her, and you know, a lot of other people too, but they don't wind up as nice as her. They wind up, you know, with an unfortunate accident. So they're scared to death, as they should be. They didn't realize when they got into all this that it was that bad or that all pervasive. I've tried to help them, my peers in school. I've written books, I've done things, trying to show them, but they don't listen. They keep thinking there's going to be another solution that's going to be a much better solution than a tabling of one system and a bringing in another, that why do we have to throw the baby out with the bathwater? So that's where they're at. Okay, I accept that. I still love them. You know, they've allowed me to have my say. I try to not, you know, have them serve me food. Oh, no, it's not because of them. It's because of the thing that runs them. That's right. They are just weak. The thing that runs them is very powerful. And, you know, they use these people to live in this world, and then they want to go take out the Christians. That's right. That's what we're talking about. What do you think we're talking about? It's a bleak day, ladies and gentlemen, and the thing is, if you're having a pity party, by now you're laughing your ass off because I'm funny, right? Am I funny? Is this funny? No funny stuff. I'm just joking with you. I'm in a great mood. Is this funny? I don't know. I'm in a great mood, but I'm very cautious. I'm in a great mood, but my eyes are on the perimeter. I'm in a great mood, but I keep my vigil. I've got to. I had to survive. I don't get to just cut up and let my hair down like all the rest of the fools out there because we're in a war. I have to be very cautious. You know, but not constricted. Look, my prayers lately have been for the good people in our CIA, which, of course, online, if you say anything good about the CIA, you're a shill. But we need the CIA. You know, technically, we need all these people to be functioning the way they're supposed to be functioning. We need the good generals back in at the Pentagon. We don't need pagan generals trying to run things. That's a joke. We don't need the dead try to lead the living. That's another joke. We need the neocons the heck out of there. We need the Bush family out of there. We need Obama that's basically tied to the Bushes out of there. And Soros and the Bushes are tied together too. They're all tied together. The Koch brothers and Soros and the Bushes and even bankers I've known in Los Angeles, they're all tied together. Don't you understand? They got on me for criticizing Soros. They go, George Soros is one of the most successful. All they see is how successful he's been, all the money he's made. The ethical questions are out. They don't even think about that. They just think about money, money, money. So I became a pariah right off the bat. Well, I have to deal with bankers, you know, but, you know, we just have to not talk politics, I guess. But I don't see Soros as any different from George W. Bush. They're on it's the same team, isn't it? This global New World Order, you know, get the caliphate, you know, follow the Albert Pike letter. You know, but I'm sick of all that. All the other people out there are talking about all this stuff. I'm talking about coping. I'm talking about the supernatural aspect of it all. You know, the prophetic aspect of it all is from the Bible and from the general flow of what's going on. That's where I need to be, because that's why you pay me the big bucks. That's stuff you can't get anywhere else. For me to repeat the geopolitics of the people that are awake out there, what good is that? There's hundreds of them on YouTube, but there's a lot of disinfo agents too. They say 90% truth, and then there's that 10%. Well, what about you, Z? You talk about how you're not concerned about the Zionists. You don't think the Zionists run everything. No, I don't think the Zionists run everything. No. That they're the real seed of Satan. They run everything. No, I don't think they're the seed of Satan. Run everything. No. You're talking about the fact that you hate the Jews, right? The Jews did everything. What happened to the people that hated the Catholics in the Vatican? I mean, they seem to have kind of been diminished lately. The Jew thing has been really ramped up lately. I don't go against the Jews enough. That makes me a shill. They're serving, you know, human meat in McDonald's burgers to children. They're getting us to commit the satanic rituals of cannibalism without our even knowing it. It's all the Jews doing it because they hate the Gentiles. They want to overthrow the whole world. That's the Zionist thing. If you change the word from Zionist to Satanist, you'd have me on the same page with you, but you'd have to make that concession, which you don't want to do. So we're never going to get to the bottom of that. What about the flat earth? You know, the people that are really in, have the Holy Spirit, they know about the flat earth. The NASA's a big liar. It's like, okay, so that's your second point, right? That I'm a big liar because I'm not going to weigh in on the flat earth one way or the other. When God tells me to weigh in on it, I'll tell you what, I'll weigh in on it, but not until then. But as far as I'm concerned, I haven't been able to deal with outer space right now. I'm dealing with this. How do we cope with this situation? The Jews run the media. I've known a lot of Jews too, and they don't run the media. The Jewish thing is really a problem. I mean, this is an ancient horror. This is something beyond, you know, this is not just I stay away from conspiracy theorists. And what about the war they've had on Jesus, the conspiracy theorists, talking about 9/11 truth on the one hand and how Jesus is a myth on the other and your Jordan Maxwells and all that? I don't buy any of that crap. For me, those people are all living in La La Land. They're spinning fairy tales. None of that is real. I don't care if there were three temptations of the Buddha and the Semiramis, the Isis and the Osiris myth and all that. We had a Messiah too. And, you know, this whole virgin birth thing is an old motif. And I studied all that. Joseph Campbell, Mircea Eliade, other people. I read it all. I took, what was that magazine called? Parabola. And they go on and on and on with the brainwashing, the sort of, intelligentsia left-wing programming of, atheism through study of mythology. Yes, I understand. I overstand. Then the latest thing I've been getting is when I hear people doing the black supremacy thing, that the Israelites are are black people and all that. I mean, I watch that and then I go, well, then if you're going to say that, then you can't possibly have true information everywhere else. You know, that's just as bad as white supremacy or brown supremacy or yellow supremacy, whatever color you like. I didn't want to walk with that. That's why I kind of distanced myself from the underpinnings of the whole reggae thing, because there was this thing being pushed about. It all makes me uncomfortable. I have people listen, they don't want me to say black, the word black, talking about people, because that's not the way people talk, I was told. So I'll just say it about white people then, white, African-American, how's that? Well, I'm not going to say white. I'm going to say, am I European American? I am a mix of things. So I don't know what I am. I guess I'm some kind of color, but all these colors don't make any sense to me because it's only George Soros and company that wanted our colors to fight each other. Here in New Mexico, I deal with people that you would call Hispanic, mainly. And they don't point out that I'm white. I mean, I have a friend, Hispanic guy. And, he does work for me, but we've become friends over the years. And he has a brother that is just as white as, like, he came from England or something. And I was always wondering about that. And he's a musician, so I've given him keyboards and different things. And, that's what he does, I said, you guys don't look related, totally, But anyway, I deal with Hispanics. When I was in Hawaii, I dealt with Hawaiians. I just never had a problem that way, But I don't know, I guess I'm rare. The problem is meaning that, look, I'm grateful for any human interaction. I don't care where it comes from. I'm just saying, all this stuff to divide us, it's just done a wonderful job at destroying our country. That's all. That's all. The whole racism thing has destroyed the country. People who push the racism, which are usually, quote, educated white people, are pushing the, you know, liberals, pushing the racism thing, calling everybody racist. And this was just this program of destroying our culture and destroying our country, and they did a good job of it. My bias is, yes, I'm libertarian. No, I'm not a bigot. I figured out I'm not a bigot. But I figured out the guy who just called me a bigot is a bigot. That's right. Usually the bigot name callers are the bigots themselves. So, you know, I am educated and I am not a bigot. They want to call me that because they have pet things that they say, that they have these pet theories that if I don't go along with it, they want to call me names or you names or label you a shill or whatever. This is a form of social shaming. Hey, guys, it's never worked on me. I never shut up 1 second. In fact, I'll double down on it. Keep on with what you're saying. I'll double down and triple down. I get more listens than you anyway. I'll triple down and quadruple down. You want to shame me and make me shut up? I'll talk 10 times more. The main thing we're trying to do now is get these people out of the pity party who are our brethren, and I understand why they're there. I've been there myself. But usually when I'm in a pity party, you want to know what the problem is? I still haven't come out of the world enough. I'm being bummed out by the world that I'm supposed to be free of. I don't have my eyes enough on Jesus. Instead, I've got it on the world and what we've lost rather than what we're gaining. I've got the cup half empty rather than cup full. I'm not looking at it realistically because my faith in my life has gone to the Lord. Therefore, the Lord provides. Therefore, the Lord gives me joy. Therefore, the Lord is my hope. But the Lord is the definition of hope, is he not? So that I'm doing something. I'm sinning in some way that's providing my pity party for me. I'm doing it to myself. Now, when I'm in my pity party, which has been less and less. When was the last time I was in one, Trish? When was the last time I was in a pity party? It's been a while.
Yeah, been a while.
She can't even remember. So it's been a while. I used to be in one every other day. I know there's people out there, I know who you are, you know who I am. I know who you are, and I see you're in that pity party every other day. Okay. Well, first of all, good news, bro, because that's the brother I'm thinking of. You're going to be out of that party. Naturally, over the next 5 years. I know, what do you do in the meantime? Things are so supernatural right now, you're not going to have time for the pity party. Things are going crazy. Other people are noticing the gang stalking is ramped up. Yes, my friend, gang stalking comes from witchcraft. So therefore, this season, it's ramped up more than it's ever been. Yes, I travel someplace. The conversation I was just having at airport A, I get to airport B, something I just talked about on the phone, they're talking about right in front of me, things like that. Yes, that's the spell. That's it. No, there is no network of that. That you're in a supernatural dimensional attack thing from the supernatural spiritual realm. And it's not some network of people that is waiting for you when you get off the plane or when you drive to your destination, who are going to have mention the same words to you that you just heard on your cell phone. No. They're trying to mess with you. Yes. No, it's not contiguous stalking. No. May we be clear on that. This is just spiritual warfare. Everybody goes through it, but the more sensitive among us are the TIs, okay? They're the sense, they pick up on it more. There's a lot of other people going through the same thing, but they just don't give it much mind, if you know what I mean. As you keep walking with Jesus, it will stop. Just like if you're a UFO abductee, it'll stop. If you had demonic visitation, sex. By the way, those of you being electronically raped, it's succubi, succubus stuff. Witchcraft. Yeah, you think it's in a machine, it's witchcraft. Yes, they can have sex with you. That's what the alien abduction, all these pretty girls, right, that you see on YouTube, they're having sex with demons. That's right, it's real. And they claim to have offspring with them, and they get shown the offspring in dream states where they dream. They get shown lucid dreams of these offspring. There's a whole story that goes along with it, but they are severely deceived. Sure, there's a hybrid offspring because of they harvesting of seed and you know, male and female DNA and tissue and whatnot, and they're making hybrids. So what? Hybrids are not in the Lamb's Book of Life. When there are hybrids and clones that are running things, is that a problem? Soulless beings have always run things when it's a satanic planet. But when this planet is not, or if you like, planed, I'm not going to side up with anybody on that. Let's just put it this way. In this situation, the living are the living and the dead are the dead. Hybrids are the dead. Only God can breathe the spirit of life into a person. You know? They found that with clones, like when they clone sheep and stuff, there's just something a little bit not quite right there. You know, there's something kind of, and I've heard, you know, read things about, you know, earlier death and, you know, just not quite, you know, it's kind of more of the Frankenstein thing, you know, the soulless thing. You know, there's a being there, there's a spirit there, but maybe there's not a soul. Maybe that's what it is. Well, eating cloned foods, I wouldn't recommend, you know, recommend eating GMO foods or anything else. They try to shove it down your throat. It's like a Soylent Green thing to get humans to eat humans. It's all part of the satanic ritual. Yes, witchcraft. Thank you. War on God. Thank you. Next, please. It's all explained in the Bible perfectly. Go there. Get one. Read it. Bury yourself in the Word, and then you'll have lots of comfort, lots of healing. Well, you can get it on your iPhone now. I mean, there's no excuse. I have it right here on mine. And if I need to get a scripture right now, oh, gosh, it's just been a tough. This Christmas season is the worst, by the way, witchcraft of all time since the Roman Empire. Why so much? Because they are feeling threatened that they might lose it. Because God seems to be moving, and they're scared to death. So they think stupidly, as most witches are not, never going to be your brightest bulbs in the box, they think somehow they could do a ritual against God. That's why I'm saying that. I have a reason for saying they're not that bright. Because doing a ritual against God is, of course, ridiculous. No, I know they don't acknowledge God as a person. I understand. They have gods that they appease. Some are very bloodthirsty, by the way. Oh, yeah, they demand a lot of bloodshed. Some of these gods that these witches serve. But those gods are at war with the God, the Creator. They want access into here. They want to run things here. That's right. So they can wage their war against God by taking God's creation away from God. I mean, it's just really simple. And I know that just sounds like a right-wing bigot. You just sound like a right-wing Christian bigot against Wicca and all this other stuff. It's like, no, I'm not. I'm just saying exactly what the truth is. If you can't handle it, that's your problem. There's no right-left-wing about it. Of course, you never hear left-wing Christian, you know. You only hear right-wing Christian. I wonder why that is. No, I already know why that is. That's an oxymoron. Anyway, as far as the Bible is concerned, well, a lot of people don't understand the Bible. I mean, like I said, that guy, that Star Gods guy, you know, he's a really nice guy, and I really kind of like listening to him, and then he gets in this whole thing about Jehovah being a psychopath, and that, you know, and that we're stuck under this dome, and that the God who made this world and made us, he's torturing us to death in this dome. That's Richard's thing, you know, and not that I, you know, but I know he's a lamb, you know, I just know he's like, so I cut him, you know, I'm like looking at a little brother there who's like, I don't know, probably the same age. I'm looking at this brother there that's just, he's in that kind of God is a psychopath thing, and I God bless him, I'm sorry, I understand that he belongs to God, ultimately, I know that, isn't that weird? But he got burned by Christianity. I mean, look, he's out there, you know, saying God's a psychopath. He's got other people joining in. Yeah, God's a psychopath. I'm having a miserable life too. And that's, he's appealing to people who have misery. And finally he's saying, quit having Stockholm syndrome. Put the blame where it belongs on the God that made you and is keeping you under this dome. He's the psychopath. He's the real problem. Oh, I used to be right there where he is. So I understand that. There was nobody that could convince me to come out. I was hanging on to that because that was some source of comfort for me, that kind of mentality. I've got so many people in this pity party. They come and they go, why is God punishing me? Now, if you hook up with this guy on YouTube or whatever, you'll get a lot of ammo against God. You'll start feeling good right away. It's God that's doing it. He's the problem. Of course, it becomes absurd. You can keep saying that month after month. Oh, gosh, the Bible showed up with these margin notes. I don't want to edit anything. And I'm back on Revelation 18. And the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee. You ever heard that before? And the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from me, from thee. And all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. The merchants of these things, which were made rich by her, the subject of my song, shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing, and saying, alas, alas, the great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, for in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught. In 1 hour, the entire world system collapses. And every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, the great city wherein we were made rich, all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour she is made desolate. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. I rest my case. Ladies and gentlemen, you will never hear it said like that. I mean, quite like that. I just read. I don't know. You can read it for yourselves. I mean, just right in the context of everything. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, and you holy apostles. Well, that's you guys and prophets. That's some of you guys. For God hath avenged you. You're having a pity party because God, you're not avenged because it's all unjust, right? Unfair? Well, God comes in, and for some strange reason, when Babylon goes down, it almost seems like Babylon goes down on its own from internal corruption within. You know, it's like the derivative scandal, right? It just collapses. You're talking about commerce, though. It's going to affect everyone. But yet the Lord says, wait a second, instead of wailing and gnashing your teeth, you need to rejoice. Let them wail and gnash their teeth. Come out of her so that you do not partake of the plagues I, the Lord, am about to send her. You didn't think we were going to let this thing go on forever, did you? No, God waits for the end for the final finale. I mean, the Bible is very, if not just an epic finale. Then you have the feast day of God, which is Jesus, you know, returning on a white horse, right? Coming in to slay the servants of Babylon and have the birds feasting upon their flesh. Some grisly imagery there. So you get two chapters of the wrap-up. And then as we start moving into chapter, you know, the 20th chapter, and let's go ahead and look at that. So you got a huge dramatic wrap-up there. And then by the time we get to 20, we see an angel come down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and the great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Well, that's called a dimensional shift. By God, that's quite a shift. He laid hold of the dragon. So the dragon, the serpent, the devil, Satan, Lucifer, these are all the same thing. The dragon, and also, may I add, the queen is also Satan. The world queen, based on Semiramis. They tried to make Mary the new Semiramis. Have you noticed? Well, I know. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. Thrones. Not throne, but thrones. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. Oh, my goodness, we've seen them, haven't we? And for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, meaning you didn't let your DNA get changed, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Okay, let's go back to, get me out of there. I want to go to the Old Testament real quick. I just keep coming back to, you know, we keep doing this. All right, let's get over to Daniel. I'm just going to go to 7 real quick, and then I'm going to jump to 11. And if I can find this thing in Daniel. Okay, and there were given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. And right before that, we have, as concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. So the forever kingdom is established. Now let's go to Daniel 7, 8, 9, 11. We'll just cut to 12, cut to the chase. And at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince with standards for her children of thy people. And there for a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, or even to that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered. Every one shall be found, that shall be found written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to everlasting shame and everlasting contempt. Now I'm going to go to 11. Okay. So the king of the north shall come and cast up a mount and take the most fenced cities, and the arms of the south shall not withstand, neither his chosen people, neither shall there be any strength to withstand. But he that cometh against him shall do according to his own will, and none shall stand before him. And he shall stand in the glorious land, which by his hand shall be consumed. I'm having to jump down this next piece, and then and some of them of understanding shall fail to try them and to purge and to make them white even to the time of the end, because it is not yet for a time appointed. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself over every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is the determined that shall be done. Neither shall he regard the king of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. But in his estate he shall honor the god of forces, and a god whom his fathers knew not shall be honor with gold and silver and blah, blah, blah. Thus shall he do in the most strongholds of a strange god, whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and shall divide the land for gain. He shall also enter into the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown. But these that escape out of his hand, even Edom and Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon, he shall stretch forth his hand also upon the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. But he shall have power over the treasures of gold and silver, and over all the precious things of Egypt, and the Libyans and the Ethiopians shall be at his steps. But tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go forth with great fury to destroy and utterly take away many. And he shall plant the tabernacles of his palace between the seas of the glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end, and none will help him. But these echo the times of today, right? In other words, we have the Middle East being torn up, everything divided. We have all the wealth and the power of the hands of a few. And we have this last beast kingdom, which is what it is. Daniel describes it earlier, and then he comes back and describes it again. And this falls, and then the forever, but Daniel always talks about this forever kingdom, you know, which then parallels in the book of Revelation, this forever kingdom that no one shall take away. And even, and it's even, you can glean from it, this interdimensional kingdom, when the book of Revelation starts talking about, you know, in the last chapter there, the New Jerusalem. And you have to understand something, that's just like a whole different way of life. It's a whole different thing, you know, where the power comes from within us. The light is within us. We are self-generating. It's a very, very different state of affairs. You know, it's so far beyond what your concept of supernatural is that it's almost incomprehensible what we become. But the finale is really God delivering his people and restoring them. What do you mean restore, Z? Were they really there before? Yes, they're being restored to the throne of God and to the thrones, plural, which I read today. Where have you seen the thrones, plural? There's only one throne ultimately, but there's a shared throne, right, of the saints of the Most High and Jesus and the Lord, and the whole thing is just one. But it's, you know, your place is there. You're not separate from the throne of God. You're there. I don't see old Satan, the devil, being in there, or anybody else. The human is. The ones who overcame, the ones who were chosen to be there, whatever. But then I don't see an earth anymore. I don't see the cosmos. The God obviously has the power over the entire cosmos to change it at will, to change the laws of physics, to change everything at will. This God of forces is the God of forces of, it's funny when I said God of forces, didn't you immediately think Star Wars? Isn't that the God of forces? It's the ultimate God of forces movie. No, they're not using it for evil. Look, you use it for good, Luke. You use it for good or evil. It's up to you how you use the force. Yes, there is a force. It's a free will is the force. And that's very powerful. If you align your will with the Lord, then of course you have all the marbles. If you don't, you don't have any, but you have the illusion of having them all, but you really don't. And there's this, you know, you want to live in Disneyland or do you want to live in the real kingdom? You want to live in the real kingdom. Well, the real kingdom, you don't have pity party days. You're not out of it. You're not suffering. You're not having a terrible time of it. When you're truly delivered, then the things of this world have no further grip on you. If they go to war, if they don't go to war, if they do this or they don't do this, nothing surprises you anymore. You just got to keep your eyes in the kingdom. Whether you abase or whether you abound, it's all good in Christ. I mean, that's basically where you have to wind up. We have to all wind up there. I can't worry about things. I mean, you know, I could worry, but I don't want to worry because I know the Lord's got my steps. And, you know, if one day you're prospering and the next day you're not, I mean, you know, I've been through that before. That's what happens. We can't expect at all costs to be taken care of. It doesn't work that way. We hope for the best. And I hope for the best for my fellow Americans. I really do. But it seems like there's just a small number of us who are willing to go against the social shaming. Because, I mean, the political correctness is you should hate America. It's racist. It's homophobe. It's Islamophobe. It's phobe. It's xenophobe. And you should hate it, want to overthrow it and bring in something, a goodwill and tolerance and a brotherhood of manner of the John Lennon song. And unfortunately, there are things like that idealistic song, they don't exist upon the earth and they never will because of what's inside of us. And only the Lord could deal with what's inside of us. Man has tried. He tried to like start giving himself lobotomies at one point, you know, to see if that would stop him from the same old, and it doesn't. Making a cover for sin and institutionalizing it is how we got into the place we're at right now. Unrepentant sin is seen as pride before the Lord. Pride goeth before a fall. Don't you know that? Every kid knows that. I'm here. I hope all humanity. Look, if it's up to me, I'd cut everybody loose. I'd say, hey, you know, here, you're totally empowered. You're in need of nothing. You're all supernatural. Let's go get a pizza. Play's over. It's all good. Love to end the trauma and the pain. Love it. I love it. I can't just level a charge of psychopath at Jehovah, Yahweh, the one God like my friend online has. He has, it's an obvious position he's in to blame God. But he's almost one step of joining the New World Order people or the lizards or whatever you want to call them, the reptilians. He's just one step away from joining them in hating God. It's a tough spot to be in. Many people have tried to go it alone. You have David Icke out there. You got all kinds of people trying to, you know, kind of do it the New Age way of love and light and just God's in me and I've got God in me. I got the music in me. I got God in me. You know, we're all good. It's all good. You know, can't we all just sing Kumbaya and head off into eternity and escape this awful matrix? There's a lot of people doing that. You know, tons of people online doing that. And if it, you know, I would join you if there was any credence to it at all. There, unfortunately, there is. It does make you feel good. It's nice to think about love and light and having happy regard for everybody except the misguided Christians. I mean, there's a certain power in that. But it's the power is being given by the wrong side. You know that now. Come on. Well, some of you have had unrealistic expectations. And now things are so horrifying, you can't even imagine how it got to this bad a point. You just can't even figure that out. It's just like so bad, right? But you got to put your eyes on the Lord, seriously. Because there's it's beauty and it's grace and it's loveliness. And there's so much good, you know. Please don't be fooled by the movie they're running 24/7 to brainwash you that it all sucks. Because it doesn't. Let's get ourselves out of our ruts and routines now and try to break out, do something a little bit different today. That's something we could do, you know. But know that if you're with God, the Lord's with you. And he's trying to, at least through this podcast, jar us loose from the programming of negativity and lousiness they give us every day. There are good people in places of power in this country trying to do the right thing. They're overwhelmed right now, but they could use your prayers, and I'm certainly praying for them. And I'm praying for the leaders to have changes of heart. I mean, you know, you don't always have to be on the side of the death cult. People do repent and come out of there. Other people, they say that, well, when you've been there 15 years getting your feeding from that trough, you know, it's too late for you to come out. Well, I admit it would be kind of dramatic to see something like that, but stranger things have happened. So I can't really count anyone out. I don't know the disposition of most people out there. I know the spirit and vibe. Being a musician, I always pick up on the vibe because I play by ear, so I always can pick up on stuff, you know, and I'm also able to jam and things like that because of the picking up on the spirit of what's going on, because music is very much spirit, so you pick up on it and you jam, right? So you know, the thing I pick up on with the lizards is basically that they are overrun by demons, and that they thought that the way of the world was the great way to go, and they didn't realize it was being run by a bunch of psychopaths, I don't think. Or they just, like, there are people out there who for money will kill their own children. I mean, there are people like that, and, you know, I don't really want to give them any money, do you? You know, and watch whatever they put on, or go watch MTV, or if it's fraught with, I don't have time to, like, is this one any good, or maybe this guy there's some hope for. You know, I kind of look at it and go, gee, everyone in the system is corrupt. Well, we pray for some to wake up. But if you do, don't expect the applause to keep on going. The applause stops. How many people are willing to put up with that lack of applause and money? Well, my question to you would be, well, how much more do you need? Why can't you go run your own business? Why can't you do something on your own outside that system? Of course you could. And God will bless it. I know lots of people doing that. And God will bless it. Well, if you're in a position like that, and you've benefited from this situation, then God wants you to denounce it, obviously. You know, to denounce it as for what it is. Not saying, making up, or, you know, stating an opinion or something, but the facts about, you know, what you've seen, what you've done, you know, your testimony as to why you believe that going the way of, say, Hollywood and indoctrination and the whole sex agenda they have, and death and the paganism and the whatnot. I mean, why, you must have a reason why you find it's distasteful. With me, it was because the people are so shallow, you know, that, I mean, no, I don't have a virtuous reason for not being there. It's because the people were so shallow and so kind of evil, you know, that it was such a turnoff to see they were satanic and wielding powers that regular people didn't have. And when I saw that, and the wielding of powers, and the UFO thing was tied in, the alien, you know, the demons of the UFOs and all the rest of it, and the special privileged class these people turned into, and then how crass and awful they are to their fellow human, all in the name of equality and liberal politics, I just had to walk away. Not that, you know, I had to walk away because my eyes were opened. You know, I gave it a pass for a long time too, and then I saw how it really worked, you know, inside baseball. And at that point, I couldn't, you know, deal. I'm like, I don't want to be a murderer, you know. I don't want to murder people. And my friends that all went running that direction, they didn't think it was murder. And then when they found out it was, then they all shut up like clams. And they've been suffering ever since. You know, stuck in that situation, hoping for a miracle one day. There's a lot of people like that too, that just innocently fell into it, didn't understand what it was, and the next thing you know, they're blackmailed and they're stuck in a situation they can't get out of. That's tough love, you know. It's like, it's so to get out of it, you know, it's just basically give your life to Jesus Christ and walk on out. But they tell me, but they'll get me. I'm like, well, not necessarily. There's a lot of people that have just walked on out. You know, just you're done with it, walk away. I remember John Lennon made a song, you know, I just love watching the wheels go round and round. I really love to watch them roll. I don't remember the next one. It's like, I've been spinning around on this merry-go-round, you know, merry-go-round, but I just had to let it go. In other words, he was talking about letting the whole thing go. And then he was killed after that. So, I mean, it's like, okay. I understand the fear of death is the thing that keeps people on it, on the merry-go-round, right? You stay on the merry-go-round because you're afraid if you step off, they're going to kill you. You don't know where it's going to come from, but somehow you're going to get dead. That's a very, you know, welcome to the NFL. The same thing happens to Congress. It's called witchcraft is what's keeping you there. Intimidation, witchcraft, you see bad things happen to other people, you don't want that to happen to you, so you toe the line. And you try to make the world a nice place around you. You know, try to do as many good things as you can and try to make up for whatever and, you know, do the best you can from within the system. I understand. I fully understand. Trying to make it work out. And then you reject God, reject the Bible, reject all that stuff because that's evil telling you, you know, shame on you and all that. You go with, you know, the New Age thing where you're making good out of what you've got rather than this whole punishment thing. You know, Yahweh the psychopath. And I understand that too, very well, that argument. And so you make it a good world as long as they aren't there. So you go, I'll tell you what, I'm going to play this song by Soundgarden called Blow Up the Outside World, and I'm going to make that my theme song. Yep, many, many people have tried that. They're trying that right now by getting rid of people they don't like. Soundgarden just basically made a statement they're going to keep the Muslims out. No, I mean, they basically made a statement. They want to blow up those who they don't like. They use the term blow up the outside world. That is the perceived Judeo-Christian culture that they're at war with, that they want to get rid of so they can let their hair down and really be themselves and have a great time about it. In a lovely world, now that the bad guys are all blown up. And see, they would couch it in such lyrics that they could, in a very cowardly way, stand behind there and not put out, you know, threats of violence like the rappers do, right? Because they're just so sophisticated in their thinking. And, you know, someone got to them. In Seattle, where these people come from, there's this whole, like, super leftist kind of thing that, you know, if you really want to be on the inside of the musician thing, you gotta kind of be up with that. And that's very much a blow up the outside world kind of mentality. You know, like these people are too stupid to figure out whatever. They're just retards. Let's blow them up and so we can have a decent world. You know, get rid of all these bigots and, you know, get rid of all this flack. So my friend would always stick that song in my face, you know, back when I was in the 90s, when I was writing scripts and making movies and stuff. And, you know, little horror movies I was working on and things, you know, nothing really big, but, you know, just doing my thing. And you're trying to be of service. What a joke my life was then. What a joke. Nothing to be proud of, let me assure you. But, you know, this guy, his name was Glenn, he would always keep referring to that song. He really loved it. And it was... is like his own secret little thing. It's like, yeah, to him, blowing up the outside world, he was talking about me. But he enjoyed putting it in my face because I didn't know what it was about back then. So he wanted me to kind of sing along with him, you know, and he got a thrill out of me, you know, doing myself, and he got a thrill out of the satanic ritual, I believe, of, you know, getting you to do the thing you wouldn't do or say the thing you wouldn't say, right? If you only knew, because you're too stupid to know. So therefore, look, he's singing Blow Up the Outside World. Or you can join us here inside, huh? Where we're really cool and above you all. So it's a predatory song written for predatory purposes by predators. who are, you know, in their own pagan way, believe that by killing everybody that doesn't agree with them, they're going to have a better world. That's basically what the song's about. I mean, I don't even think the writers of the song even knew what they were writing, but that's what they were writing. That's what so many of these rock stars write, you know, dumb stuff like that. It makes them look stupid because whenever people get the mentality to blow up the other, right, the other over there, the enemy, the perceived enemy, it always comes back to blowing everyone up. That's where it eventually gets to. So that's a stupid position that they took. But then again, if you spend your life, you know, playing in bars and trying to be cool and stuff, what do you think you're going to write about? What are you going to write about? What is there to write about? How cool you are and how dumb everyone else is? How cool it is to all be on the same vibe and the same team with Satan and everyone else is stupid? You're not the first people that ever came across Satan, you idiot. But see, that's what every generation does. They feel like they're the first to ever discover the glory of Satan and the pathway of, you know, do what thou wilt and the fun of all this tolerance and how cool it is to be on the inside rather than on the outside, uncool, uncouth, squared, you know, bigots and all these awful people out there, racists and... Yeah, there's, you know, they're stupid. They just, we need to tell them what to blow up the outside world. Then it's just us cool cats. Yeah, I wouldn't be proud of that. See, I'm glad I didn't write a song like that. I'm really, because I don't have to live that one down. Oh, see, that song will be there for eternity. So since we're eternal beings, they're going to come smack face to face with the implications of that at some point. And it won't be cool anymore. I'm just glad I didn't write it. Well, that's why they pay them the big bucks. Because you make all these, you know, little surreptitious, mind control things that influences a generation. And so they pay you. Why would they pay you otherwise? What other way are you delivering souls to Satan? You're not. That's the only way you can do it. So you get, you know, you get credit for that. Or there's the way of sacrifice, you know. Neocons would be great at that because they want constant everlasting war. So they're constantly providing trauma and souls to their god. What other god would there be for neocons other than the devil? What other god would there be? Neoconservatives, the American century, forever war, 9/11, global domination, whatever. I mean, you know, the New World Order, which is the ultimate cry of the neocon. What other religion would there be but Luciferianism? What other god would they serve? Certainly not just themselves. What it would, otherwise it wouldn't, you know, keep going generation after generation, right? They'd want to go for the gusto now. Part of the reason they don't have their, what they think is the New World Order, which is already here, by the way, it's already here. So it's like, when this falls, this is it. So this falls, it's the, you know, well, what about the mark? I admit that we don't have an official mark yet in that way that the Revelation describes it. Perhaps you're right. We have to wait till that happens. But I read something about the sacrifice in the temple. The abomination of desolation, that there's something going on now that fulfills that. But we'll see. I'm not really that much of a Bible timeline guy. I love the Bible, but I'm not a Bible timeline person because I've seen so many of these timelines wind up not being fulfilled the way the people thought they would be fulfilled. They eventually will be fulfilled, but not on the time schedule that people keep trying to set a time schedule. And I'm like, you know what? Forget about that time schedule thing because it's always a disappointment and people always lose faith. And you know, then when you lose faith, folks, you go into a pity party because you ain't hooked up with the world system, number one. All your Christian teachers are, though. I'm just kidding. No, it's true, but I mean, it's true and not true. It's true in a lot of cases. Well, it is true, darn it, it is. Jeez. Because when you have a Christian leader, then Satan will be all over that leader to conform because then they're in a position to do some serious good work for the devil. So they're recruited. Because of how many people they influence. The Zeph report, even though it's, you know, up and seems to be exponentially growing and listeners and listens, it's exponentially growing now. I don't know why that is, but it's kind of ridiculous watching it. It's accelerating, but still it's under the radar because we don't have an influence over millions of people like on YouTube or whatever. We're just a small little, you know, I mean, I get things from the Lord and I give them out, you know, and then I get music inspiration from the Lord, like Revelation 18. I told you to pay attention to that. We've been looking into it. We'll look into it. Don't worry. We'll look into it more. But is there really a changing of the guard going on a la Revelation 18? I think there's a good chance of it. But then people tell me, what about the Mark of the Beast? Well, you could have the Mark of the Beast introduced, let's say, as a DNA thing. And because they say in 20 years, everything will be chipped. Everything will be chipped. Everything. So I could see that coming in maybe 20 years. But by 2018, I don't know, because we're getting, you know, it's already 2016. I'm not sure. But we'll see. You could have the kind of collapse underway of Babylon and the chip all at the same time, too. So again, it's just we wait on the Lord. What's your opinion of the cosmos? I'm waiting on the Lord on that. When God's timing is right for me to take a position on the cosmos, it's all a big lie of NASA. No, it's not a lie. It's lots of spinning objects. They're all globes. Or no, they're not globes. The sun is a globe. We're going around the sun. Nope, the sun's going around us. All that stuff will be addressed in its own time. Why is it such a big issue on the internet? Because it's doing a great job dividing people, isn't it? So I don't want to talk about that or geopolitics. I have to pray for Obama. I can't just keep painting him as some, you know, kind of like actor guy that's like puffed up puppet who's leading a double life because of his, you know, whatever, who's off playing golf and the media applauding him and this whole other kind of bizarre psychosis to join in that. I can't do it. I got to pray for him to come back down to earth. And if he truly is a Christian, if he really does have Christian faith, like they talked about the Washington Post the other day, if he really does have a Christian faith, then it's time for him to come home to repent and to not aid and abet ISIS that cuts off Christians. And see, it's hard for me to believe someone that's protecting ISIS and even commanding them or growing them or funding them or whatever against the will of the American people could possibly be a Christian if they're cutting Christians' heads off. Yeah, a lot of people believe he is a Muslim, but whatever. You know, he's on the dark side, obviously. He's on the side of an occultic dark side death cult. But no different from Bush before him or the, you know, this constant litany of, you know, sort of fake presidents and things that we've had. I don't know FDR, you know, World War II, you know, Korean War, and on and on and on. Vietnam. Now this, what has this been going on forever? You know, it never stops. It's the gift that keeps on giving. Now something's coming to a head, and I think it is. And I think if you push into the Lord more, the gang stalking thing, okay, you get off the phone, you're talking about your mother named Anna. And then you go to the market, they're talking about a mother named Anna. I understand. But see, God will just make you a lot more insensitive to that sort of thing. Let him try. That sort of thing is not coming from a guy listening to you talking somewhere. That's coming from the supernatural spirit. That's spiritual warfare. That's not coming from terrestrial means. I'm not poo-pooing the idea that they use machines. I'm just saying. All of it, even the guy running the machine, is subject to the spiritual warfare. There's an interdimensional aspect where there's things being used that don't even exist yet here. All of it is part of spiritual warfare. When you finally connect the dots, then you realize the only place you can go is Jesus Christ. You got to just really push in there. Cling! Don't be a bitter clinger. Be a happy clinger, but cling. If you're looking for a different message than this, or you want me to be really interesting like Star Trek or something, this is not the podcast for you. This podcast is going to redouble and redouble and redouble on Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life, and the way out of this mess of your miserable and my miserable existence, that we can be truly joyous and truly a force of good in the world and of good in other people's lives and good and going at some of these problems in our society to reform them and not just being a cynical pile of misery sitting on a bump on a log complaining and grumbling about everything that exists. That is not what God wants us to be. I could do it just based on old age and feeling, you know, my own infirmities. I could just sit there and start complaining about it all. I know plenty of people that do. Look, folks, it's Christmas Eve, man. It's going to be the highest day of warfare in the world. Because everything is arrayed against God. Why wouldn't it be arrayed against God's Son? I don't care. If they said April 25th was Jesus' birthday, then it would be arrayed on April 25th. They keep trying to convince you that the satanic calendar has nothing to do with Jesus. It's an old trick. It's propaganda, folks. This is the highest time. You people that have the gang stalking thing, the coinkydinks are going to go off the hook the next 5 days. It goes from now all the way through New Year's. It's tough. It makes Halloween look like a joke. It makes Beltane look like a joke. Because they deny they have anything to do with Jesus. That's just right-wing bigot Christians like Zeph. So, all the experts on Satanism don't know what they're talking about either. I'm just going off I'm just going off experience. Okay. I can feel it out there. It's cosmic. The air, the atmosphere, the airwaves, everything. The interdimensionality of it, it's all ramped up right now. If you want to say, feel sorry for yourself as a TI, go ahead. But recognize that it's a universal spiritual war right now. We're all getting it. We're all having to deal with it. It's targeting the earth because, you know, obviously, to win against God, we have to hurry up and get this thing in, this utopia, this genocide, this mass annihilation, this depopulation. Depopulation is part of the satanic agenda. Agenda 21 is the satanic agenda. The UN is the satanic agenda. It's all tied in, and they want to get what they've been waiting for thousands of years in right now. A complete autonomy against God, even higher than God. You little people out there, you little, you know, musicians and artists of all types, you know, like we share something in common. The best thing you can do is to be a force of good, right? I'm sure you understand that. But would be to get beyond the mind control of, you know, the anti-Christian mind control, as well as the pro-Christian mind control. Get beyond all that and then assess it from a new position. Notice I'm not telling you to believe anything. I'm not trying to convince you of anything. I'm not evangelizing you. I'm not doing anything. I'm just saying, for your own good, for my good, for everybody, do your own investigation beyond the Christian mind control. You know, I mean, I used to run into people that say, we're going to win taking back the world for Christ. And I know that scares the hell out of you. But what if everything you heard was a deception, one way or the other? They're pushing you one way or the other. It was all propaganda, but the real deal was still the same. What would happen if that was true? Everybody tells me that Yahweh is Molech and Saturn, and that, you know, we sacrifice children to Yahweh because that's what he wants. Well, nobody admits the sacrifices. You know, they happen in our world. They don't happen quite like before. They're more like accidents and, you know, and little wars and skirmishes and terror attacks and things like that. You know, there's it's all done kind of in this with smoke and mirrors so that people never feel that they're a part of anything. It's like when they're eating Soylent Green, they're eating their fellow humans. They never know. But the Satanists are all getting off on watching them eat it, aren't they? Well, you bet they are. McDonald's, I'm seeing people that I watched when they were talking about Hollywood and the whole initiation, indoctrination into being a star, being a rapper, being a rock star, being an actor, being a this, being that. But they lose me when they start talking about McDonald's getting meat from Jews of sacrificed and dismembered and children made into like hamburger meat and then feeding them to the public through McDonald's. I had heard a broadcast where someone sent me that broadcast of a radio show with the rabbis admitting that all Jews worship Satan, that Yahweh really is Satan. It's all about child sacrifice. It's just some messed up stuff. It's hard to keep going. I just have a lot of doubt about it. I think when someone's pushing that, like list running off a bunch of conspiracies and then that's one of them, I sort of feel like you have to, you know, from that point forward, you have to, anything they say you have to hold is, you know, maybe not believable. I always want to know if there's like good people in Hollywood. Of course there are. There's good people in Hollywood who are working, yes. Who are not, you know, continuing with the indoctrination. They're not sacrificing family members to stay famous. They're not having to be in gay orgies all day long while they go home to their wife and kids later on. That none of that's happening. Yes, there's good people in the military, everywhere. But see, what they want to do, what the enemy wants us to do, is paint all this with a broad brush, it all sucks. Then our credibility is ruined, right? Because we know it all doesn't suck. We know from the Bible that the wheat and tares grow together. It's a real messy, complicated mess. It's what it really is. So by signing on with all, they all do this, or they all do that, or the Jews this, or the CIA that, or the, I pointed out a lot of the satanic deceptions like architecture and different things. But awareness by the public would mean that in future remodeling, that kind of architecture wouldn't be. I also saw that they installed two Baphomets now with signaling the go, go, go for the pedophiles because the two kids, a boy and a girl, are looking up lovingly at Baphomet, the devil, Satan, obviously the big pedophile. And there they are in Detroit and in Tulsa. Well, I say those statues shouldn't be. Especially if they're taking down Christian statues, they should definitely take that down. But because that's the law of the land, ultimately, what they're trying to instill, you know, that's a mind control device. That gives you, what does it give you? The kids approve of Satan. The kids with the adults. The kids being guided by Satan. Where would that lead? That's right. Look, it's not the best podcast in the world today, probably, but at least, I showed up, and then my goal is to get you out of the pity party. You know, did it help? Well, I've often said that I could cry for the rest of my life for just what's happened to me, what's happened to my friends, just in my small universe, I could cry forever. Can't do that. I can cry when the war's over, but I just can't cry right now. I get choked up into tears, but I gotta suck it back because there's nothing wrong with just having a good cry in your room, but you know, I just can't, we can cry later. You know what I mean? Sometimes when we're crying, we're not perceiving it right too. But a pity party loves a good cry because then you're all beaten down. You've had that release of crying, right? It's a big release. And then it just makes you all weak, and then it's easier to, you can go further with that pity party then, after a good cry. Rather than a good cry because you're bemoaning and you're wailing and you're mourning over the deaths and the awful atrocities and the horrors of this world. And then after you mourn, you're ready to go again because you've spent all that out. You've got all that out of your system. When I cry, it's really good because I feel like there's a kind of a protection in it. It's, you know, but I can't let it go on too long. You know, there's, again, it has to be tempered with, you can cry, but keep your eye on the perimeter, right? Oh, come on, just lose yourself. Well, people that lose themselves. I got to keep a vigil against losing myself. Oh, I wish you just, oh, I do. I do cut up. I do go crazy. I do lose myself in the music. I sure do. Well, to be honest with you, I know a lot of people, they're not, quote, wearing it on their sleeves Christians because of all the bad press that's gotten. But I have a kindred spirit with a lot of them, and I don't know where they're. I've got to feel like I've got a kind of a kindred spirit with this Star Gods guy. Just I like him. I like intelligent people, you know. I like intelligent conversation. And he's promoting that Yahweh is a psychopath and that we all have Stockholm Syndrome. But I'll go back and listen again. You know, I don't know why that is, why I have friends that think that way. He said, well, you got to straighten him out. It's not for me to straighten anyone out. I've done the straightening out right here. I've, you know, believe me, this program has won a lot of souls, if you like, winning. It's not me winning any, but souls have been, you know, gone to the Lord where they should have been. Just like, you know, Hollywood puts out their own religion, right, which is winning souls for Satan. Right. Their church is the secular world. That's Satan's church. And mine is just a little small, little nothing, you know, compared to them. But obviously some of you are getting some comfort here. I mean, I it's not like I haven't been through this thing, you know, and through it. It's not like the truth changes much either. It doesn't. It's just that things have really gotten to a kind of a critical edge point right now. Well, I bid you shalom. Merry Christmas, all of you. Merry Christmas. And I won't say Happy New Year till you're going to see me again, probably. So, Merry Christmas. This day, or whatever day it is, but we celebrate the Lord's birth. You know, that led to the ultimate sacrifice, the ultimate blood sacrifice that set the world free. I don't think we should belittle it. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and there is no other. And in that, if you stand with me on that, we're brethren. I mean, I may not, you know, if you, everyone is a different, I may not jump into your sin with you, but we're brethren. And you might not jump into my sin with me, but we're brethren. Let's try to not judge each other for not jumping into each other's sin. Okay? Well, that's what I just said is very profound in this way. I'm asking a lot. You know how peer pressure is. If everyone's there drinking and you're not, you're going to be attacked. So let's try not to do that. All right. Till next time.